windy today. It's very windy. So I twisted the wire. Oh, it's a fly.
I reckon he's stuck. I reckon he might be stuck on the coax and the tape. Poor bugger. Anyway, let's see if we can get rid of him.
So I've twisted the wire together and that now tunes on 20. Amazing, isn't it? Simple little bit of capacitance. I've doubled the size of the coupling loop. It's now 120 centimetres in circumference, which is 20% of the loop. And because of that, I needed to move it down the post so it no longer couples closer. It needs to be exactly where it is, to be funny. Okay, so let's go to a CW, turn the wattage down, and we'll go for a tune. Look at that. Okay, what I'm trying to demonstrate here is the directionality of the loop. If I turn it through 90 degrees, all of a sudden the signal demigrates, and as I turn it back again, so the screen clears and the signals become more distinct, if that's the right word to use. Good morning, my name's Mike, M0MSN, and I realise that a lot of you do not have 3D printers. So I thought I would remake the loop using household products, i.e. Some plumbing pipe, and this is how we got on. I'm using 40mm and 50mm solvent weld pipe available from local DIY stores. It's normally used for waste pipe, but I found it absolutely perfect for making the magnetic loop stand.
I need to cut it there so I've got a bit more of a handle on it all. And then I need to bend things.
This is a capacitor that was donated to me by Andy, M0JLY, to which I thank him very much indeed. This is for the magnetic loop project that I'm playing with at the moment. It's quite a large capacitor, I don't know what the range. I'm going to test that now. I've adapted it slightly. It came with the motor drive, but it wasn't wired in, and I've just stuck a socket and plug on it, and the cable goes off to this battery here, it winds three revolutions a minute, which means this transfers incredibly slowly because it's actually on a gearing on the inside, which is a by looks about 10-to-1 ratio. Anyway, I'm going to test the capacitance in its present state. That's not a particularly good stand. So unmeshed, it's 27-28 puff. And what I'm done there is I'm going purely from the center to this bank here, unmeshed. 28, call 27.5, let's call it. Now, if I go from bank to bank, where, there we go, it would then more separation, which is, so it's 14, 15 puff, and the center would have to mesh between the both, which is a butterfly. I might use that. Okay, so it's at 15 puff. Fully meshed, it's 165 if you go across the banks. Now if I used just the one side of the bank, get 324. So depending on how I wish to mesh this really, isn't it? I think I might just use, okay. So what my intention is to cut this in half. Okay, and have half the capacitor, so I can make two capacitors out of the one. Because I only need about 80 puff to bring it to the 40 meter band. So let's try that. Great things about capacitors that they're very, very simple. The downside is very, very fragile. So if you get this wrong and you end up bending all of the fins, you're in a little bit of a nightmare situation. So that's a very simple construction. You have to be quite delicate. Thank you. So here we go, I've removed 17 fins or sets of fins and put it back together. And now fully meshed, it's 81 and a half puff across the phases or across the fins. Or if I just use the one side, it's 162 puff. So I have the ability of doing both really. Cut these off. And we have a new capacitor. It's something most amateurs will know, but I'm not sure whether it's actually covered in the foundation or not, but certainly not everyone will. If you put two capacitors in series, unlike resistors, their capacitance reduces, where if you put them in parallel, it is increased, they add together, if you like. So this is actually set up at the moment in series. If I take the center, okay, and connect it directly to the second capacitor bank, it takes this capacitor bank out of line and instantly doubles the capacitance of this capacitor. Wow, okay. You join me during the mammoth task of making the transformer loop or the pickup loop or the I don't know what you call it, the inner loop, and I've used some I think it's 8 mil central heating pipe micro bore. There's a meter bent round, which is roughly 20% of the total diameter of the outer ring. I've bent it into a circle, flattened each end, snipped a little bit off to give a bit more, less area for the soldering iron to heat it. And I'm about to solder the coax to it. There's a little bit of glue-lined heat shrink, just to make the joint a little bit neater. And I also want to generally just make it all a bit neater if I can. Now I'm using 100 watt soldering iron to do this. I'm hoping it's going to be hot enough. I don't really want to resort to a blowtorch if I can avoid it. The downside to 100 watt on coax is that it will melt it instantly. We don't want that to happen either. There we go, okay. As you can see, the soldering iron works incredibly well. Okay,
It's also eating away the tips incredibly quickly too. Okay, let's just quickly solder these. Goodness gracious me, that's really hot. I don't know if it will shrink this far, to be honest. But it's not overly important. It's glue line, so.
We have our capacitor. And we have our loop. The only way I could get a low SWR is by turning the loop off of access, which means that it's too big, because less of it is coupling, and therefore the loop is too big. So I need to take it off to reduce the circumference stroke diameter, and try again. So I'm going to take, 15 centimetres off of it. Resolder it and see if that brings it back in.
Participation, sir. 73 in the block. 73 QFZ Oscar Papa.
Mike Zero, Mike Sierra November.
November.
Mike Zero, Mike Sierra November, 59 into the town of Gloucester. Five and nine also, thanks very much. Good luck. Right, I've got it on narrow FM, so I can get a carrier. I may go to CW, it depends on how sharp the Q on this loop is. I want to do this as quickly as possible without treading on anyone's feet, so let's go right down to 5 watts, which is the lowest I can get on this radio. I just want to queue up, see what the SWR is. As you can see, no movement. And we'll measure the SWR from when it gets to 2, right, in both directions. So we're at 7119, as you can see. Okay. Let's go up. Bang. So 7:30, 7130. Okay, so let's go back to 7119. Well, that's close enough. 7:20. 7:20, there you go. So 10 kilohertz up and it pops off. So let's go that the other direction. Wow, okay. That's a very sharp cue.
There you go. As you can see, the magnetic loop has got quite a high cue value. Very, very sharp. About 10K either side of the central frequency, which gives it quite a high efficiency rating. Now, there's a couple of websites that you need to visit to get measurements and to gauge things, if you like. One of them is, let's have a look. It's 66pacific.com. I'll put this in the description below. And also the non-stop systems is also an invaluable source of information for making magnetic loops. Well, there you are. There you go. Thank you very much indeed for watching. If you like what you saw, then please give me a thumbs up and subscribe. You have a good day now. Thanks very much indeed. Bye-bye. A big thank you to Chris and to Andy for the capacitors.
Without your contribution, I wouldn't have been able to finish this project. So thanks very much indeed.